Welcome, y'all!
Woo!
Slightly delayed that time, but still here. This is the pregame engineer tailgate mayor racing podcast for Wednesday. Sure, we're back on a Wednesday again, July 7th, 2015. I'm tailgate mayor Rusty Wallace. I'm here with pregame engineer Andrew Sherwin. What's happening, man?
Yeah, well, we had to, you know, we had to bump the podcast up a day because you and I are both going to do some pleasure travel.
Yeah, a little bit of heading out west.
Yep.
So I am headed off to Glacier National Park for the week to get away from email and phones and being a project manager. How about you?
That's fantastic. I'm actually going to Denver. To visit my sister
and
also to hang out with fellow dude enthusiast Kevin McClanahan.
Awesome. That sounds real fun. Is he a member of the podcast yet?
No, I don't think he cares enough about NASCAR to get involved with this, but perhaps I can recruit him over the weekend.
I bet you can, considering some of our topics that we've been into the last few days. So what you drinking on today? Let's start with that.
Well, I think I've revisited an old friend maybe from a few podcasts ago. I've got my my Jim Beam White Label, which is kind of a staple, and my dad's favorite Red Rock Ginger Ale.
The Don Sherwin Special. So hopefully he's listening in, and cheers to Don on this one. Hey, man, I've got something crazy and new. So I talked about it last week, I think, saying that I was going to this beer fest at the aquarium, the Georgia Aquarium, for July 4th, and then you go up on the rooftop, watch fireworks go off. I know you tried to get into that, and they were sold out of tickets.
Yep. But
one of the beers they had is this Ballast Point Grapefruit IPA. And I know it doesn't pass the whatever German purity, Ryan Gestalt, whatever that's called, the laws, because it's got grapefruit in it. But, man, this is out of San Diego. Really cool. And I'm showing you the picture. We've got video feed going, but there's a fish on the front. Really, really crisp, really grapefruity, if you like a grapefruit flavor, but not necessarily the sourness. But totally recommend that. Ballast Point Grapefruit Sculpin. I don't even know what that means, but whatever.
I don't either. I think it's a fish name. I've been very impressed with Ballast Point's offerings. And since you like that one, you definitely need to try Abita's Grapefruit IPA. It's also pretty tasty.
And by the way, we tried another one there. It's Leinenkugel, the makers of Fruity Pebbles beer, as we call it, and the the lemonade beer. They have one that is
summer shandy.
Yeah, the summer shandy. They have one that is straight up grapefruit juice. And it's alcoholic grapefruit juice, and it's really delicious.
Yeah, well, it's exactly what they did with the summer shandy. It's just grapefruit instead of lemons.
Yeah, yeah. So that's really good, and had a lot of good stuff there. I think it's time for shout outs. So I have a shout out right now that I have neglected for however long we've been doing this, man. 6 weeks, 8 weeks, whatever it is. My sister, Stephanie, and her husband, Scott, are listening to this, and they are diehard listeners, probably our first big fans. And she said, I have to talk about her for at least 8 seconds because I've been neglecting so long.
So, good for her.
So, Steph, here's your 8-second ride. Stephanie has just moved out to the Big Island of Hawaii in the last couple weeks. She was out in Vegas before then, now moved out to the Big Island of Hawaii. Her husband, Scott, just got sort of a job transfer thing over there, and they are about to live the high life, as they call it, the HI life. So shout out to Steph. Shout out to Scott. Really appreciate you both listening. And, you know, I can't wait to come out and visit at some point here soon. So there it is. Hopefully that was 8 seconds, probably a few more.
I think it was. I'd like to say thank you to Stephanie and Scott as well. And watch out for those actively flowing lava creeks.
Yeah, no kidding. You might have to take a detour to work the next day. Well, Sherwin, it was July 4th. We're all decked out, American flags, fireworks, and, you know, don't get too hungover because guess what? Next day, we had Women's World Cup, World Finals, and tell me what happened, man.
Carly Lloyd happened.
That's Carly what happened. Lloyd happened. Hat trick within the first 40 minutes or whatever it was.
16. It was in the 17th minute when she scored her third goal, and she scored it from 54 yards.
That was incredible. The old chip shot over the top of the head of the goalkeeper who was playing a little bit far out of the box. And That was an incredible match. I went out to a soccer hooligan bar. I was dressed up. I've got American flag shorts. I've got a red shirt, blue hat, and American flag cape that I made. And it was nuts. People were going crazy. I didn't know how many chants that the U.S. team had. And I didn't know how many chants had four-letter words in them. But, hey, you know, we're all at the bar. We're having fun. So that was a great time. And, you know, the first goal, everybody's going nuts. Yes, we got on the board. Yes, we're ahead. Maybe we can hold this. The second one was, oh my gosh, that's incredible. The third one was, we might win this thing. And we're talking about within the first 10 minutes of the game, 16 minute comes around and everybody's just dumping beer on top of each other at that point on fourth goal or whatever it was. So we were, that was ecstatic. That was really fun to watch. And Women's World Cup, we've been talking about it since game one, man. Props to you on calling that out prior to the first game in the group stage. And you brought it all home. So appreciate you doing that. And you got me hooked. I watched every single game. And then, of course, the Men's Gold Cup is going on right now. And I watched that game yesterday. So I'm a fan now.
That's awesome. I'm glad to have you because I know you're a good sports fan. And watching U.S. soccer is just so much fun because you get to combine being a sports fan with being a patriot. And I don't know that there's any better way to combine sports than those two. And what I would add from my perspective on the women's game was, okay, you score an improbable goal with, you know, 2.5 minutes in, and then you get a goal at around 5.5 minutes in, and you feel the quicksand set in for the other side. You feel the tidal wave building for the U.S. And I called Lauren Holliday's goal, you know, 5 seconds before it happened. I was like, oh, that's going to be a goal. And she puts it in the back of the net, and that was the least reaction I had all day or all night because I knew that goal was going to happen. I was like, that's going to be a goal, and it is. And I'm not saying I'm no genie or gypsy or any of that business. You see the situation happen, you go, that's going to be a goal. And you realize at that point at 3-0, and now we know that Japan came back and got two goals, and they're a very good side. But
well, we got one of those goals. So
well, okay.
Technically we scored six, right?
Yeah, we scored six, and you know,
and gifted them one.
Right.
Well, it's kind of like many. You can have one.
Right. It's kind of like golf. They don't ask you what it looked like; they just ask you how many.
Yep.
You know, you're trying to get as few as you can in that sport. But anyway, it's just a great thing. And then last night, I mean, you take 2 days off. The most important game in the women's soccer world happens Sunday night. It's not even over till about 9:30 p.m. And then 48 hours later, we kick off a brand new tournament on the men's side, a tournament that we are the defending champions of. There has been no more bigger momentum for soccer in the United States than what's happening right now.
Yeah, it's fun to watch. Hey, you know, this is a racing podcast. One of the big parts of racing is patriotism. And like you said, this is the greatest combination, I think, of patriotism and sporting event that you can have. Maybe Olympics is up there. Maybe, you know, NASCAR does a lot of stuff like that too, but we're not racing against the world here. So really, really cool to watch.
So yeah, I'm not trying to drive all the NASCAR fans that have been listening away from the podcast. But there's no better time to be a fan with all the television companies that are fighting each other to get the coverage and the fact that the games really don't have an off season. We like to say in NASCAR it's the longest season in professional sports. Guess what? It's not. Professional soccer actually it plays about 2 weeks longer, so their off season is 2 weeks shorter. Wow. And because of the way the men's and the women's national teams overlap and the way the English Premier League, way their scheduling works and the way the MLS, which we're going to talk something about that later. I think the way those schedules all line up, there really is no soccer off season. You can stay dialed in and there's going to be a game. You're not going to go more than 2 or 3 weeks without having a game that you want to watch.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, let's move on to racing since we are in the racing podcast. We'll probably tone down the soccer a little bit here going forward, but man, that was a fun ride right there. So first thing to talk about here, we have Kentucky coming up with the whole rules package thing. But before we get to that, Indy, Michigan, Darlington, Richmond, the four tracks that I think Steve O'Donnell, who we've talked about several times on this podcast, came out and said, we're going to be running different packages at all four of those tracks as well. So get ready and suit up and tighten the belts.
Yeah, I suspect that at Darlington, which is the one I know the least about at this moment in time, that we're going to run something really similar to what we're going to try to run this week at Kentucky. Mm-hmm. The big changes for Indy and Michigan is a half a step in a different direction. It's a really similar front downforce package in that the splitter is going to be backed up into the car or sawed off, however you want to describe it, not sticking out as far. Mm-hmm. But we're going to have a 9-inch spoiler, which yeah. means we're going to have about a 4-inch plexiglass extension above the spoiler that we have today on the standard package. And that's just to try to improve visibility through the cars.
So give us the rundown. What's that going to do to the cars?
It's going to increase drag. Yep. So what that means is straightaway speeds are going to go down. But I believe we're going to be in a similar box that we have been at some of the little bit smaller tracks than Michigan for sure, because Michigan's the fastest right now. Mm-hmm. Is that they're going to be on the throttle potentially wide open in the first 5 to 10 laps of a run because there's going to be no change to the tire. Goodyear either was not asked to or provided the feedback that they would not be able to respond quickly enough to bring a different tire. So it's a drag package basically at Indy and Michigan. I believe that's to reduce corner speed so that maybe you can pick a different line. At Indy, we know that if you're not on the bottom, you're not going anywhere at Indy. And mm-hmm. whether you're in an open-wheel car or a stock car, it's the same.
Yeah, yeah. And you said, so this is going to slow them down. And we've kind of had mixed feelings about this, haven't we? About, well, slow the cars down, bring them together, or let the fastest guy win, let the car outdo the track. Where do you think this puts us on that scale?
Well, I think if you just take Indy and you put it under a magnifying glass, then you look at the race that we talked about, I guess, 6 weeks ago now, that was so awesome, the open wheel race, the Indy 500. One of the things that was so cool about that race is that it raced like Daytona raced in the 80s and early 90s maybe, where you had cars spread out all over the track, but the draft played a significant role in the front of the field. And setting up the draft was how you had to pass. I believe they want to try to bring some of that into NASCAR. As of now, or at least the last 3 or 4 years, if you had the setup nailed and you had a fresh set of tires, you could get gone at Indy. And I mean gone.
Yeah. I don't think it's any coincidence. If you look at these four tracks, so you have Indy, Michigan, Darlington, Richmond. We're not talking about like, oh, we're going to try it at Texas, Atlanta, Charlotte, and, you know, name one, maybe Miami or something. These are four very different racetracks that they say we're just bringing a whole new package to. So I don't know what they've got in the, in their hand there that they're just trying to try stuff out here or what. But I am interested in the fact that, yeah, again, these are such four different tracks.
Well, I think the thing to realize is that obviously they don't want to bring anything new into the chase. So all the tracks that they made changes for the package on had to be before the chase.
Yeah. Now, and Richmond is the one just before the chase, right? Or is it still?
Right. But it's a unique high bank short track that we don't do anything like in the chase.
Yeah.
It is the last race before the chase. So potentially the package is going to impact who gets in.
Yeah. Yeah. That's what I was going for.
But I think if you look at the other tracks that are on the schedule, Pocono, not sure how much you could learn there by changing the race package. The racing was pretty good there before. It's going to be pretty good now. Loudon is the other one. The Loudon racing has been good for years. There's been no reason to make any changes at Loudon. And then you got Watkins Glen. And then there's Bristol, which is a whole different thing all its own. It's totally different. And I'm kind of surprised that they're going to make a change at Darlington. It wouldn't shock me at all if it wasn't any kind of geometry, if it was all – it was just tires. Because that's what they're at Richmond. They're only doing tires at Richmond. Okay. Goodyear's going to bring a softer tire, and they're going to see what happens. But, you know, Bristol only have one line. Not surprised they're not going to race there with something different. Darlington is the one that surprised me because Darlington really only has one line too.
Well, and they're kind of messing with their tradition there a little bit. Just the the fact that, well, I guess they're going back to the Labor Day weekend race there. So not only going back to it for the first time in however many years Atlanta has had it, but I don't know, 3, 4, 5 years of whatever we've had. And then also at the same time making some changes there. So curious.
Well, I think, and this is me in prediction mode and not in a knowledge mode. One of the things that made Darlington Darlington for however many years was that the sand of the lower Piedmont Plateau of South Carolina would eat that track up and eat tires up. The asphalt would eat tires up. And Darlington got repaved during the time when NASCAR was experimenting with that different polymer stuff. It's not got the same stuff that they did in Charlotte that seems to never wear. Darlington is wearing, but Darlington has been in the last 2 or 3 years a place where you could take two tires. And Darlington used to be a place like Atlanta where if you ran three green flag laps, you're going to come in and get tires if the caution came out.
Yeah.
So I'm thinking that they're going to bring a softer tire, and that's probably about it, so that they can try to appeal to what the fan base was pre-2005 when they took the Labor Day away, so race away.
Yeah, yeah. So trying to create more excitement there. Well, it sounds good to me. It's not too late to just go to that race, is it?
No, I thought that was part of our plan, because with the, you know, with the football game that we typically go to being on that Thursday night, we got an open weekend there.
We have an open weekend, and my wife does the whole Dragon Con thing here in Atlanta, and that's not exactly my thing. I have nothing against it. It's just not what I do. I do NASCAR, so I think we're in, man.
I pretty much counted us in. I knew we hadn't really had the conversation yet, but I have been planning, my calendar that we would be there.
My calendar's been such a mess, as you've seen with all the traveling and stuff. But yeah, it's starting to make a lot more sense now. So cool. We just decided. Excellent. Going to Darlington. So let's go from Darlington. Let's go to Daytona. And take a deep breath here, because we've got a lot to talk about Daytona. And that didn't sound like a breath as much as a sigh there, Sherwin. Let's start at the beginning of that race, which is rain. And they had rain at starting at 7 p.m. All kinds of stuff came through, and they didn't start that thing until, 11:30, 11:45?
I think they went green between 11:20 and 11:30.
Yeah. So we have talked about it before on the podcast here, how we are impressed. I'm impressed, I should say. I am respectful of NASCAR, always trying to get this thing in. But you know what? It felt a little it felt weird to me. I get what they're doing. I think it was a perfect storm, if you pardon the pun there. But a perfect storm of, well, they're trying this thing on a Sunday night for the first time. I think green flag was supposed to be actually like 8:03 or something like that. And so that's one of the latest green flags ever. And we're doing it on a Sunday night. And so big risk there if there's any rain. Well, what happens is rain comes. Well, you can't really race it. Or they have all the people there. And I think what they were trying to say was that they didn't want to have all those people go home. I almost knocked a light over here on the table. I'm talking with my hands here. They didn't want all those people just to go home and not have a race in when they thought that they could get it. Then again, I mean, who is watching that race besides, the diehard fans? I think you were watching it. I had early meetings the next day or something, or maybe I was traveling. I can't remember what it was, but I wasn't able to watch it. And I was just kind of like, well, if they did it on Monday afternoon, I would work from home and turn it on and watch it for sure. So I don't know. What's your thoughts on the rain?
Well, my thoughts on the rain are it's certainly nothing NASCAR could control.
Yep.
They have stayed committed to getting these races in. I believe they were put in a box this weekend in that there's several different things on my list, and I don't know if I'll even remember to get to them all, but there's a couple different things. One is, like you said, it's a Sunday night prime time. Trying to go ahead and run that race on Monday is a challenge for logistics for a lot of reasons. I suspect that they probably looked ahead to what the weather was going to be, and that helped them with their decision making. Also,
that's a good point I didn't think about, because it did rain all day Monday too, didn't it?
I think so. And the other thing is, by the way, they loaded back up and headed to Kentucky, and they were supposed to practice all day today, which we can suspend, but it rained out all day today too. Today was a total wash in Kentucky. The other couple things are, and I have no idea how close to an event starting that the TV negotiations are made, but I got to believe they were a couple years out. I think that's typically the way it works. There's no way that NBC could predict that they would have to go head-to-head with the U.S. women in a World Cup final in a sport that's exploding. And believe it or not, NASCAR fans, I'm sorry, but when the U.S. women play in a World Cup, they outdraw NASCAR about 3-1. And they set the record for the most watched U.S. soccer game ever this past Sunday.
Men, women, anything. The most watched U.S. soccer match ever. I was pretty proud of that. We're going right back to soccer. But you're right, putting it head-to-head. Hey, I said I went to this bar. I said, you know what, I'll catch the end of the NASCAR race. We've already talked about our thoughts on the plate racing that we have right now, that package that we have, and we'll get into that a little more too. And I've said before, you know, it's just them running around for however many laps, and then we're really paying attention to the last 20, 30, 50, whatever it is. And I said, well, I'll just do that. I'm going to go out to this bar, have some fun, and get back. And, of course, I haven't even started the race yet. And I thought, well, good. I'll be able to see it in the morning. Wake up the next morning and see Dale Jr.'s won the race.
Yep. Yeah, they hung on all night. And like I said, they had many reasons to try to do that. Running that race on Monday is something they absolutely did not want to do. The forecast and the weather behavior over the past 3 or 4 days suggested that when it does stop, it's done. So if you could get it dry, there would be no issue going forward.
Mm-hmm.
That played a huge role in their decision. And believe it or not, so here's the thing that made it all work for me. The ratings were stagnant from last year to this year.
Yeah, and there was a rain delay last year too.
Right. They pushed it to Saturday, or it's a Sunday afternoon last year, and got the same viewership. Now, I don't know what the competition was. I know that the rating was like a 2.5, 2.6, something like that. And that, you know, that matters more in certain markets than it does in others in terms of how many people actually watched. But I think the thing to understand is that when NASCAR draws big, you know, their biggest draw is only like a 4.2 or 4.3, and their average draw is right around a 3. So it's not like it really hurt them in ratings, which to me, I see that as a positive in terms of how that's going to help negotiate future reactions to this sort of thing and everything in NASCAR, because, you know, the fans in the Southeast, especially a lot of ones we interact with on Twitter and the ones that we see at the races that we go to in the Southeast, and their opinions are that the Southeast still drives NASCAR from a fan perspective. And that's just absolutely not true.
Mm-hmm.
Over half the fans in NASCAR are not in the Eastern time zone. And it's time that NASCAR fans in the Eastern time zone understand that.
That's a good point. I mean, if I'm living out on the West Coast and NASCAR's kicking off at 8:30 p.m., you bet your bottom dollar I'm going to be watching that race for the rest of the night. That'll be the end of my evening.
That's right. I mean, you woke up, you had breakfast, you got your morning exercise, maybe you raked the yard or mowed the grass. At lunch, you made a sandwich, you watched Carly Lloyd score 3 goals, and then you had dinner with the family, and then you're going to have a NASCAR race. That sounds like a hell of a Sunday to me.
Yeah, I hear you. So that's the rain, and here we go into – I'm sighing again. let's get through the race. Dale Earnhardt Jr. leads 95 laps, and I think we've talked last week enough about, we're just going around in circles at these plate tracks and not a whole lot happening. So Jr. leading 95, 96 laps, something like that. And then we get the very predictable green-white checkered that we talked about last time. What led us to that green-white checkered? I don't even remember. Do you know? I only caught highlights next day.
I think it was somebody blew a tire, and it was like a 3-car wreck or maybe a 2-car wreck at the rear of the field. It was one of those that you go, really?
Yeah. Yeah. And so green, white checkered, they, you know, have their warm up lap, if you will, that I'm not a huge fan of on these plate tracks, for a green, white checkered, in my opinion, you know, just sticking on this topic a bit, if we're going to do a green, white checkered at the plate tracks, why not do a green, green, white checkered on just on these two tracks? Just cause this whole get up to speed lap. I mean, there it's really hard to get a lot of good racing action on that one. So that's my tip for NASCAR, right? Or my request to the NASCAR brass. How about green, green, white checkered?
Yeah. And I think the argument on the other side of that would be is, well, that's no different than once we're already green and we're up to speed and we're running laps. So why not do it that way? It's like, actually, no, it's not. If you look at the way the field was bunched when they came to the checkered flag and what ultimately caused the wreck that happened with Austin Dillon getting in the fence. The reason why is because you had 2x2 and at some places 3x3, 10 and 15 deep, and there was no space in between any of them. You do not have that in, you know, on lap 70 after you've been green for 10 laps.
Yeah.
You know, they're a half a car length apart, and the two lanes are separated by a half a car or more. They're just not that close, and you're going to have that, you know, because like Junior said it best, and this is inside information. It's wonderful that he's on Twitter to help us out with this stuff that we don't know. He said, if you're running on the inside line, he said, you probably the only guy that's running full throttle is the guy out front. In order to maintain spacing and position, the guys behind him are running part throttle. He said, but the guys on the high line are probably 5 deep running wide open. You know, they're going a little bit farther, and the arrow is a little bit different. And that's why you see the high line all of a sudden, when those guys get in all the right configuration where the air is flowing just right, that high line takes off. And the low line really never does that.
Yeah.
Or at least it doesn't do it nearly as often. So those are things you don't think about. It's like, okay, not only are these guys running 2 feet apart from each other at 200 miles an hour, some of them they're not even full throttle. It's not like, oh, they talk about how the throttle's on the floor the whole way around the racetrack, every lap. No, it's not. Not even a little bit.
I didn't actually think about that. It makes sense. I didn't think about that really, and just thinking that, yeah, they're just wide open, but it makes sense they'd be throttling it. Otherwise, they're just going to run over the top of each other. Well, that's a good segue into what happened. We have the infamous, at this point, Austin Dillon wreck. You know, it follows the safety issues that we've had at Daytona in the spring here, with Kyle Busch wrecking in the spring into that inside wall with no safer barrier. This time, Austin Dillon goes airborne into the catch fence. Some number of fans getting treated, getting injured, maybe a few small cuts and bruises, and then a couple people had to be hauled off to the hospital. And, you know, as much as a lot of times I disagree with Ryan Newman or don't like him or whatever, he had a really good quote at the end of that race that I totally agree with, and that we said in our last podcast leading up to this race. Ryan Newman said, NASCAR got what they wanted. Cars getting airborne, unsafe drivers, same old stuff. I thought that was really strong, and it echoed again what we said last week, where we were saying what we get out of this is the ESPN highlight at the end of the race that they get to throw on SportsCenter as one of their little ticker pieces and spend 60 seconds talking about, oh, well, here's the last lap of that race. Well, how about all the other laps? That's what we care about as fans. That's why we're watching. We want to see all of it that leads up to that, not just that. And so between the green, white checkered and then this wreck that happened, you know, it's I can't agree with Ryan Newman more about NASCAR got what they wanted with the cars getting airborne, unsafe drivers, same old stuff. I was intrigued by that comment as one. And then, of course, there's so much more to talk about this, but I'll throw it over to you for your comments.
Well, there's a lot of polarity to the whole issue because on the races that we watch and we think are really good races, guess what? When Pardon the Interruption and SportsCenter and all those afternoon shows that people watch when they get home from work, the races that we think were good races, they don't show up in that little ticker line. You know,
if they do, Tony
Kornheiser and Michael Wilbon aren't doing 30 seconds on the fantastic finish at Martinsville because there's not a car about to go into the crowd.
Well, yeah, there's no story there, I guess. It's the same reason they don't report on every Major League Baseball game that happened. They're only going to go for the ones where, you know, the ball donked off some guy's head and all that stuff. So they're looking for that piece so they can get the viewership and all that. I get it. I don't want to throw conspiracy theory stuff into this. I get it. They're in their name. It's Sports Entertainment Network or whatever it is. Their whole thing is entertainment. Their whole thing is getting these clips there that they can drive viewership with. But we don't want that as fans. We want a full race that we can talk about. You and I have not talked yet about anything except the last two laps of that race so far, other than me saying that Dale Earnhardt Jr. led 95 other ones.
I don't remember what happened on the other 158 laps.
Mm-hmm.
I know that the car that I was most hoping would finish well was gobbled up in a situation none of his own doing, and had a miserable finish. So that's what I know.
So what changes should we expect, or should NASCAR be thinking about right now in order to get these races back on track? Get them. This is only happening at the super speedways. And so what needs to happen to get them with a normal type of race finish?
I don't know. I think the biggest problem that NASCAR is fighting is tradition. And here's where I'm going to bring in my all-time favorite demotivational poster. For those who don't know about this little phenomenon, it started probably a decade ago or more, but demotivational.com takes a traditional team-building atmosphere, the corporate atmosphere buzzword, and makes a snarky comment about it that is often very biting and true. And for tradition, they say, just because this is the way we've always done it doesn't mean it's not incredibly stupid. And that's something that we should all take into our daily lives, our personal lives, our work lives, our fan lives. And just because we've always done something a certain way, or that something we always did a certain way has evolved to something that is, in fact, incredibly stupid, doesn't mean we can't change it. I don't have to come up with the answer on this podcast. I'm not paid enough money to come up with an answer on this podcast. But what I do know is that if we continue to do things the way we do, we will find a situation where our advancements in safety and technology will not prevail over the situation that we can create.
Yeah. I think with about 50 more fans, we'll start having some sponsorships, and you'll totally be paid enough to come up with the solution.
Well, I think that's the whole goal of this podcast. Podcast, right? And, I mean, certainly would love to get paid to do it.
No, you're not going to hear any commercials anytime soon on this one, unless they just come at us with all kinds of mess.
Well, I do a Jim Beam and Red Rock commercial to start every show, it seems like.
I hear you. And Ballast Point just had a raving fan review here. So, you know, maybe the kickbacks will start coming here soon if the Ballast Point Grapefruit Sculpin stock rises huge in the next few weeks, and they go searching for what their marketing did.
Perhaps I need a new strategy with the podcast Twitter handle. Yeah. Going after brands instead of people.
Yeah. So, you know, that was really a bummer. You hate to see the fans getting involved in this. And, you know, some of the drivers have said it. Tony Stewart famously said it a few years ago when one of the cars went in the catch fence, and he says, you know, we get in these cars assuming this risk. We know what's going on. But the fans are just here to have fun. And so it's a bummer to see fans getting involved in that. I don't know what it takes to get those cars back on the ground, but I think one step toward that is getting rid of this, like you said, this tradition that we've had of this style of racing. That there are, you and I both think there are better alternatives, and we've seen those better alternatives, had the taste of them. So,
We didn't see any cars get airborne under the tandem program. And the other thing I would say is let's be real careful about how we talk about aero sensitivity and what caused Austin's car to get in the air. It was absolutely a mechanical disturbance by so many cars being so close together that caused his car to get airborne. The car actually folded on the right side and rolled over onto the car to its right. At that point, because of the speed, became airborne based on mechanical impact. Now, of course, the air had some function to do with how he struck the fence, but the air was absolutely not the reason why the car got off the ground to begin with.
Yeah, that's a good point. I mean, if they come out of four that deep and that wide in Michigan, if they do that at any of these tracks, they're not going to do it at Bristol like that. But any of these fast tracks like that, yeah, that same thing's going to happen.
So it could absolutely happen at Michigan if the right number of cars were together at the same time.
Yeah, but that's not the strategy at the end of the race either. To get up ahead. So you're not going to see that happen. And so as long as this is the strategy with this pack versus the strategy, like we talked about with like a tandem draft sort of deal, you're still going to see this stuff. So,
yeah, I mean, I'll just go out and go off the deep end. Solution for me is to eliminate this racing. However, you know, the second or first most powerful company in NASCAR that isn't NASCAR is ISC, a publicly held company that is owned by the NASCAR family, the Frances. They own Talladega and Daytona. There's no way this is ever going away. I think the thing they need to understand is because we did this in 1962 or whenever that track opened, the technology has come so far that the 2.5 mile and the 2.66 mile high banked oval doesn't work for the car that we have today. Something has to change.
We'll leave it right there. So, Dale Earnhardt Jr. won. We talked last time the Jr. won. You know, it feels good as a fan, and I'm not even a huge fan of Dale Jr. or anything. Not saying I don't like him, but just saying he's one of those neutral guys for me. But it's always good for the sport. It's always, and especially with his seemingly turnaround in his attitude, his style, now that he's on Twitter and stuff. We've talked about this before. So cool to see him win.
Yeah, well, Dale Jr., all you need to know about Dale Jr. is the first comments that came out of his mouth after he crossed the finish line was to comment on what he saw in his rearview mirror, which was to be frightened to death by what may have happened behind him, and to ask for information about who was in the car that hit the fence, how they are, and how the fans were. He did not even react to his win until he knew that Austin was safe and that anything that happened in the stands was a very minor, non-lethal, non-threatening situation. And that's all you need to know about this guy. He just won a race. You know, he's still trying to resurrect his career and trying to figure out how the hell to be Dale Earnhardt's son. Mm-hmm. And the only thing he cared about after leading 95 laps and winning the race was, I hope that driver's okay, and I hope nobody in the stands are hurt.
Yeah, and if you're listening to this podcast and you haven't seen that wreck, at this point, all the fans, to my knowledge, they were all in stable and good condition. The ones that had to go to the hospital, the ones that didn't, either got care there at the track or even refused care, just saying, it's just a little cut, I'll be fine. And Austin Dillon walked away from it with just some bruising and stuff. So with that, because I don't want to recommend any snuff films for anybody out there, but you should go back and watch that and see what happened and slow that down. See the mechanical failure Sherwin was talking about. See the carnage of that car, and for a person to walk out of that is unbelievable. It does say a lot about the safety of these cars, but the style of racing and how that ends, I think that does put a sour note on that. But I think it's worth going back and watching and analyzing.
Well, there was a really cool moment. you had the Casey Mears crew guys, and you had Dale Earnhardt Jr.'s crew guys, and then you had, of course, Austin Dillon's crew guys raced the car. I think mostly it was Casey Mears' crew that got there first. And they're digging in there and trying to figure out if the kid's all right. Mm-hmm. And once they figure out he's all right, everybody throws thumbs up that he's okay. And the crowd goes wild. And then Austin climbs out. He acknowledges the crowd. And he does a signature wave that hit me in the heart so hard because of how big a fan I am of a movie called 8 Seconds.
Yeah.
That was about the life of a bull rider named Lane Frost. And to hear the story behind that and how that tribute came about, you know, on Friday and Saturday nights when Austin's racing in the Xfinity series, he and his crew, in preparation for the race, they watched that movie to drive inspiration to perform well because they have a lot of respect for Lane Frost and what he was able to do. And the movie drives a lot of emotions. For anybody who doesn't know, Lane Frost was killed in his prime. At one of the biggest rodeos there is, at Cheyenne. And so the movie will really move you. I got goosebumps right now. It'll move you. It'll move your heart. Remember that it's a Hollywood picture. They're not everything in the movie is true. But the man was real, and he was a great bull rider, and he was a good person. He drove a lot of inspiration. So behind all that is Austin has a wherewithal that he's already planned. He's going to use this move the next time he wins, which is kind of a wrist wave, hands-up wrist wave. That was a Lane Frost thing. And he has the wherewithal to get out of the car after he's, you know, who knows what happened inside there.
Yeah.
And what it was like, especially after Brad Keselowski broke loose on the oil or cut a tire or whatever and hit him after the fact and spun him around 3 or 4 more times.
Yeah, yeah.
While he was already on his lid. And he gets out and he does thing to the crowd. And you know, a half hour, 45 minutes later after – Dale Jr. does his victory lane celebration, and it's time to start drinking beer and be happy. He sends out a tweet, and he says he's incredibly impressed with Austin Dillon for having the wherewithal to give a Lane Frost tribute to the crowd after getting out of the car after that crazy wreck. You know, that's all you need to know.
Yeah, yeah. And I read the interview that he had with Marty Smith, I think, is who had interviewed him. And I did find it interesting hearing about the sort of slow-mo that was going on while he was flipping and hitting the catch fence and all that. And he was saying at each hit, his belts would loosen a little bit, which means the next hit was worse because he's got that momentum hitting up against the belts. And then the next hit and then the next hit. And he said finally he thought it was over. And you think, you know, this is over. I've survived this. I can feel my fingers. I can feel my toes. I'm going to be okay. And he was just at that point, I think he was on his lid at that point, waiting to be extracted and thought it was all over. And I think that's when it hurts the most when, like you said, Brad Keselowski hits that patch of oil or whatever and slams into him. Nothing he could have done. I even saw at the end, they were talking with Brad Keselowski, who said that he was in the ambulance with him, same ambulance. Going back to the infield care center and said, man, I'm sorry. What can I say? I'll say my bad, but I have no idea what to say here. I totally, of course, don't mean to hit you. It's not my spotter. It's not me, et cetera. So yeah, unfortunate situation I thought, but ended up in a, that was an interesting part of that story. I thought the whole belts loosening thing.
I agree with you. I agree with you. That was very interesting and enlightening.
Yeah, insightful into what's going on in the car then. So, our picks. I have to admit, I put my faith in Danica. I'm going to say that maybe it was the, you know, if we'd have started this race at 7 o'clock, I think she would have done a lot better. I have no data to back that up, as usual. I have nothing to back up any of my points. But that's what I'm going to blame it on. I need a scapegoat. So I'm pointing at that, and she ended up 35th. Like I said, I didn't watch a race myself, so I don't know what got her back there, or if it was just losing the pack, or if she got caught up in a wreck or something like that.
She got caught up in the same wreck that Casey did.
Okay, I got you. And then Tony Stewart, not a bad pick for you, Sherwin, finished 14th. You know, it's funny, in Daytona, when you see somebody finish 14th, you kind of go, okay, well, he had a chance.
Well, typically, if you finish 14th, you never gotten a big one.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Exactly.
Well, I thought one of the funny things I saw on Twitter, and hopefully I can do a good enough spotter impression, that talking about the situation with Austin and coming and right as they cross the start finish line, that Tony's spotter was going above clear.
Yeah.
Because if you rewatch, I shouldn't be laughing. If you rewatch that last finish there, Austin actually does this kind of a barrel roll thing just right across Tony's windshield before he hits. And Tony never hits anything on Austin's car or vice versa. Wow. But it just, you know, it like they might have could have locked eyes when he went over. I don't know.
Yeah, flipped in the bird a la Top Gun or something.
Yeah, definitely.
Tony 14th, you know, before last week's podcast, you told me, well, I kind of want to pick Harvick, but let's see where it goes. And you ended up picking Tony. Harvick finished fourth and had a chance. So what can you say? He's just sliced bread or well, he's not the sliced bread. Everybody calls Joey Logano or whatever. But he's absolutely money on every track right now, and just racing his brains out. So, he finished fourth. That would have been a good pick too. But yeah, I liked our picks, unfortunately didn't end up for us. So we're moving on to Kentucky. We're talking about rules package changes here. So looking forward to that. I'm going to be in some mountain in Montana and there's no way I'm going to be able to watch that race. So I'm going to have to either catch it on the replay or more likely, catch up on Twitter and Facebook and everything else to kind of get the lap by lap and see what happened probably posthumously. Are you going to be able to watch that at all?
Probably not. My plans right now, so Friday night for the Xfinity Series race, I'm going to be headed to watch the Braves play the Rockies at Coors Field.
Oh, man, that's so cool.
You know, I don't know. Those games usually they go off at 8 or 9 o'clock in the mountain time zone, so that'll be, you know, 2 hours after the race starts. So I'm planning on not being able to see any of it. Mm-hmm. I may DVR one or both of the races. Saturday, same deal. Really unique opportunity, especially leading into our final topic. I'm going to go see the Colorado Rapids play the Real Salt Lake MLS match.
Man, you've got a heck of a weekend lined up. That sounds awesome.
Yeah, I'm pretty excited about it.
So picks for Kentucky then. I'm just going to go random because I'm not going to be able to watch it and I'm not going to be able to do much research beforehand. But as Darrell Waltrip says, I'm picking Matt Kenseth.
Kenseth, that's not a bad pick at Kentucky.
Yeah.
I think Gibbs has had some success there in the past. I'm glad you went Kenseth because it allows me to do what I really wanted to do.
Excellent.
And I'm going to be all in on the home team.
Drum roll here.
I think it's Casey Kane's turn.
All right.
He's been really fast at Kentucky. He's excited about this race. The package lends to his likes as far as what the car is going to do at speed. I think it's time for Daddy Kane to win one.
Yeah, it is. It is. I'm a little bummed. I'm going to be missing it. I'm going to be in an amazing place. I'm probably not going to be thinking about it, but I'd really like to see this race. But c'est la vie. So let's close this thing out, man. We've got two topics to close us out. We're going to bring us down a little bit, and then we're going to bring us back up. Starting with and let's not go into names here. I think you've got a little bit to say about it. We had a sports figure in the last week who, it didn't happen in the last week, but it happened in the last few weeks. But we had video released who had an altercation with a female at a bar and is now suspended from said operations. Again, I think everybody who's listening probably knows or can easily look up who it is. But let's not talk about that. What have you got to say, Sherwin?
Yeah, I don't think there's any need to name names or name places or schools or anything. This is a golden rule kind of a thing. It feels like, to me, it's one of those things you learn, you know, maybe when you're you was knee high to a grasshopper, or maybe about twice that high in that whole 3 to 7 years old range, depending on how many girls you were exposed to when you were youngin', that were either your family members or friends of your family or et cetera. The first time that you got into a physical altercation with a female, and your parents told you that, or especially your dad said, we don't do that. You know, we don't hit is something you hear. You know, you don't ever, most parents aren't telling kids to get in fights. They absolutely are not condoning or telling boys to get in fights with girls. And so I'll make it short and sweet. Do not hit women. There's absolutely no reason for it. You can't find there in a list 100 items long. You cannot give me a valid reason to hit a woman.
I can't agree more. And you and I have said this at races, at some of the races, at some of the wild and crazy parties and stuff that we've had, tailgating for 3 days and going to the races. What was the one thing that we said? Nobody ever gets arrested. People have their beer taken away if they're underage. People are pulled away from each other if they're in a fist fight. But what's the one thing that can get you arrested at a race?
The one thing that we've seen is hitting women.
That's the only one.
If you can, break almost every other law that doesn't, it's not a felonious situation. As long as you're not committing a felony, the only misdemeanor that can get you arrested at a racetrack is hitting a woman.
Yeah, and it's sad the times that we have seen that happen. And of course, all the you got to give it to rednecks, man. All of them standing around outside in a circle around the tent. The police officer's there hauling him off. He's already been hit a couple times. Not the police officer. The fellow's been hit a couple times already by somebody. And leaning over, all the rednecks leaning over to each other saying, man, did you hear he hit his wife? And they say, yeah. He said, it's a good thing them policemen got to him before we did, huh? So,
well, yeah. I mean,
the people who do know the golden rule there.
Yeah, the classic example of that, I think, might have been my very first time camping at Atlanta Motor Speedway. Dude smacks his wife, and then he catches a beatdown of a lifetime right before he goes to jail.
Yeah. Oh, and the cops will turn a big old blind eye to somebody getting roughed up after that sort of deal.
That's right.
Yeah, yeah. So, all right, we brought him down. Let's bring him back up, and let's close this thing out. You can see me. I'm wearing an Atlanta Falcons T-shirt, so we're bringing it hometown. For the closeout here, we just had an announcement for the expansion team for MLS that we've been anticipating for a long time. Arthur Blank is creating a new stadium for the Falcons and this new team to share. And I'll let Sherwin take it away and tell us what we have.
Yeah, well, it was announced when we got the new stadium that part of the deal was that we won a bid, or Arthur Blank, I should say, won a bid for an MLS team in Atlanta. And, of course, everybody sort of knows that, if you know Atlanta, that they, you know, red is going to be part of the colors.
Yeah.
And if Arthur Blank's involved, it's probably going to be black too. But I'm very pleased to say that the third color, the accent color, is going to be gold. And that sticks with the Atlanta Falcons tradition. If you go back to 66 when we got the first team and they wanted to pay tribute to Georgia Tech by putting the gold pinstripes on the helmet.
Yeah, this one's a little more pronounced too. The entire A is gold, and I believe we've got a couple stripes in the background, so that's pretty cool to see. I'm a big fan, and we've got Atlanta United Football Club. I didn't know if we were going to be, you know, the Atlanta some other bird, because we always get birds. I think I said it before, I was hoping Thrashers, because I've already got all the stuff, but I can do Atlanta United Football Club. It sounds good. It doesn't sound too European. It doesn't sound too, you know, when you said like Real Utah or whatever, it's like, oh, what are you trying to do there? But yeah, I can get behind this. So I'm a fan. If you're not a fan of Atlanta United Football Club, then let's have fighting words.
I think it's great. And I finally made my commitment last night. I totally forgot there was an event downtown to sort of make some announcements about the club. I think to release the shield and all that stuff, which is a big deal. International soccer, so we're trying to mimic a lot of things they do in Europe. You say, well, why would you want to do that? Well, I suspect a lot of people listening to this podcast don't realize that the biggest sports business in the world is European soccer, and it's by a bunch. It even makes the NFL sort of pale in comparison. So that's, if you're following that model or mimicking that model, that's a sincerest form of flattery for a business that works really well. So I like it from that perspective. I saw a stat today that made me very happy. They had offered a deal that you could be a part of the founders group for the Atlanta United Football Club by committing to a refundable $50 down payment on season tickets, which I did last night. And their total commitment, so I committed to two tickets. Like I said, it's refundable. You can sort of change your package as you go when it's offered. But they already have a commitment for 20,000 tickets. And I think the way the new Atlanta Falcons football stadium was set up, that the soccer, the MLS soccer standard setup was only going to offer about 2,300 or 23,000 seats. So to have those potentially all filled by season ticket holders means that they might open up more, or that place is going to be absolutely slammed every game.
That would be bonkers. So we're looking forward to it. Hey, if you love us, tweet us. If you hate us, go ahead and tweet us. You can find us at PETM Podcast. And I think we're ready to roll it out here, Sherwin. I'm Tailgate Mayor Rusty Wallace. That's at Tailgate Mayor.
Yep, and I'm Pregame Engineer Andrew Sherwin. That's at Pregame, ENGNR.
All right, and we'll talk to y'all. Well, we're not going to be here next week, so we'll talk to you. Maybe we'll have to do a Sunday or Monday deal, Sherwin.
We can do that.
All right, we'll talk to you then, buddy.
All right, man, have a good trip to Glacier. I'm going to enjoy everything that Denver has to offer.
Rocky Mountain High, baby. We'll talk to you later.
All right, bud.